everybody. So cross-device identity. Gosh, that's something that we write about all the time at AdExchanger. It's very fast-moving. In fact, I'd say change is the only constant in this area, and very hotly contested. And with good reason. I think in a remarkably short amount of time, we've gone from a world where the PC is the center and the cookie is the core ID mechanism for that, to a world where mobile is the center. PC, obviously still meaningful, but the cookie doesn't work so well. And meanwhile, you have things like connected TVs coming online, and you could see the Internet of Things on the horizon. So just very dynamic space. Three companies on stage who are focused on kind of solving for that challenge I just outlined, including two kind of arch competitors in the cross-device arms race. So
ready to duke it out.
I'm psyched about this. Let's just have you each introduce yourselves and tell us who you are, who you work for, and also tell us who your customer is. So if you could just share, is it the agency media buyer? Is it the marketer themselves? Or is it the technology middle layer? Just to give us a sense of where you position in the ecosystem. So let's start with you, Tim.
Tim Jenkins, CEO of 4Info. What 4Info is known for in the marketplace is the company that literally made mobile measurable at the offline cash register. Mm-hmm. And we could do a whole show on that, but I promise I won't. Our customer actually is mixed. We have as much direct brand access as we do agency buyer access today, and it really just depends on how they want to work with a platform.
Okay, great. Thanks. Kamakshi.
I'm Kamakshi Sivaramakrishnan, founder and CEO of Drawbridge. Drawbridge's mission is to democratize this core notion of anonymized digital identity. By developing a technology solution that connects consumers to devices in terms of the multiple devices that a given consumer owns. This has become an increasingly challenging problem, as Zach just mentioned, with emerging devices like wearables on the horizon, mobile devices, phones and tablets, personal computing devices, televisions, connected televisions. And the way we have brought this solution to market is by developing a technology stack that certainly solves for the advertising and marketing automation problem, but we also have a data licensing model under which marketers, brands are able to access this core asset of identity, bring it in-house for a variety of data analytics measurement problems, but more broadly speaking, it has far-reaching applications around content optimization, recommendation, personalization, anti-fraud, risk, et cetera, which is extremely exciting in terms of what it means to develop an independent, open solution for identity.
Okay, great. And before you go, I just want to say the clock is not ticking. So if somebody backstage wants to start it, otherwise we might go 2 hours on this topic. Mm-hmm. All right, go ahead.
Right, thank you. Otto Traasdahl, I'm the founder and CEO of TAPAD. The whole inspiration for us really started 5 years ago, where we was attending the CES show and saw these big screens and small screens and medium-sized screens, but realized behind these screens there were actually just separate companies, and the big challenge is around just unifying this experience for advertisers. So the first couple of years we had zero customers because nobody thought that made any sense. But then it started turning around, so now we probably have about 200 of the largest brands in the US as customers. The agency groups, the agency holding companies, most of the trading desks within those holding companies. About a year and a half, 2 years ago, we launched licensing, where we're licensing out the underlying data and technologies, about 45, 50 companies on that list, like the Oracles and the Nielsen's and all of these type of companies that are licensing our data so they can make their cross-device solutions. So I think we're covering most of those companies that you mentioned.
Great. So you serve multiple customers and constituents, and then you have a data licensing business, you also have a media sales business. I got that that's true for you too, Kamakshi. True for you as well, Tim?
Yes.
Okay, so you still are selling media as well as having this data asset?
Well, I'd like to just qualify that as saying that it's more a technology licensing rather than a media licensing. So it's a self-service SaaS platform that we've developed for agencies, trading desks, et cetera, to be able to log in and manage, have a one-stop shop solution for managing media and executing it across devices, knowing the identity of the consumer.
Okay, great. Now, I had originally wanted to talk about accuracy to kick off this panel, but Kamakshi, you said, no, let's talk about open versus closed. I think, Ari, you were into that. So let's start with open versus closed. In cross-device, you hear about these two ways of doing things. One is deterministic, and that's sort of matching devices based on an authenticated login, and that's what Facebook does. And then there's probabilistic, which is people, this is what it has meant historically anyway, people like yourselves, you know, applying algorithms to huge data sets to make really educated guesses that functionally serve the same purpose. So, I think we'll get back to that and the whether the distinction between those two methods is still meaningful. But for the purposes of this open versus closed discussion, marketers are used to hearing that, you know, Facebook is closed. It's data in, but no data out. Google, same story. Whereas often independent companies will talk about openness. So tell me, if you wouldn't mind, Kamakshi, let's start with you on this one. What does open versus closed mean from the marketer's point of view? Why does it matter?
I actually think that the conversation is less about Facebook and Google versus the rest of the world.
Okay.
I think it is more about the opportunity that an independent asset around or an independent technology solution around identity creates.
Mm-hmm.
It creates the opportunity for democratization. It creates the opportunity for a universal currency for identity that is fungible, tradable, and applicable for multiple use cases, even outside of the advertising marketing technology stack.
Mm-hmm.
From that perspective, I think the only way to democratize identity mm-hmm. is to have an open and an independent alternative or a solution set. So I think that's sort of the position that we carry. One more point I would like to add there is that I think we've gone through multiple phases and types of democratization.
Mm-hmm.
Salesforce is a classic example of what democratization did to software on the cloud. Data management platforms in our own industry is another example of what democratization did to consumer data.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the next wave or the next revolution is democratization to this core notion of what this consumer identity is, because we are talking about this frontier, which is the next exciting frontier of personalized internet. And that's only possible if currency of identity is constructible. And that is possible if you're talking about an open ecosystem.
Okay. Ari, do you want to field this one, open versus closed? Why should the marketer care?
Right. I think that's Kamakshi is describing now also is the kind of emotional journey of a CEO and
mm-hmm.
entrepreneur in the cross-device identity space, because in the 5 years ago, nobody cared about it. And then there was a period where really all companies that figured this out really could scale and grow in a way. We were one of them, or we were all three one of the those companies.
Okay.
And then about a year ago, then the announcements from the big tech companies came out. Okay, now everything is going to be deterministic.
That was Facebook 1 year ago this month.
Yeah, exactly.
They launched people-based marketing.
Yeah, and then all of the excitement's like, oh no, this is going to happen now. How am I going to now feed my family? But then actually right after that, we started, two things happened. Number one was, the phone would never ring as much as right after those announcements, because now these big marketers came and said, what you guys have been talking about for so long, I want to do that everywhere, no matter what the ad server is, or it doesn't matter for me, I want to do cross-device and identity on huge scale.
Mm-hmm.
So that was good. The second thing that happened was that the marketers started inviting us in to show what the marketer is thinking about, and I think that's one mistake that most of us in this industry do, is to think that advertising is marketing. And if we're sitting in this room with this marketer in Detroit, and they have a room where they have all of the touch points with their consumers. So everything from like considering buying a car, now I'm in the purchase funnel, and I bought a car, and now after that, I'm gonna consider buying a new car. But underneath, they have all of the marketing systems that they're using, and there are 300 systems underneath for email, for point of sales in stores. There's like 300 of these ones. Advertising is a small component of that. And it's back to what Kamakshi said earlier as well. For a marketer, they need to have a unified identity across this entire ecosystem. So with that,
not only is advertising a small part, they're outsourcing it to their agencies often.
Very often outsourcing to the agency as well. And the two tech giants that you mentioned are a part of advertising again, right? So plus they would not share their data so that that marketer could get this holistic journey and have the same identity on this consumer through this entire journey.
Okay.
So that's when the optimism started to come up again. Oh God, this is actually, we're actually onto something big here, and we can help solve a marketer's true need for a holistic view on this consumer.
Okay, thank you. Tim, I think you have a little bit different perspective on this one, so let's hear your take on open versus closed.
Yeah, I mean, you know, marketers want choice, right? I mean, marketers want the ability to be able to spend on the platform that's gonna give them the best return on investment, one. So if you have a few walled garden players out there who are gonna become the default, what you're gonna find is a very narrow view of your consumer, right? Social, 14% of time spent or 20% of time spent, depending on which survey you read, is spent on social. What about the other 86 to 80% of the time? And what people are doing on their mobile devices is different, whether they're playing a game, looking at a shopping app, a cooking app, or weather, and you need to be able to capture all of those touch points and all the things that they're doing, not only what they're doing, but where they're doing them to get a true 360-degree view of a consumer. If you stick with a walled garden provider, you're gonna get, I think, a narrow slice of the consumer. So I think that's problem one. Problem two, if it becomes a default, marketers are gonna lose two things they've been fighting for desperately for the last 5 years, which is transparency and better pricing. I mean, we've yet to find a situation where a monopoly or pseudo-monopoly actually works in anybody's benefit.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great.
You don't mind, just a quick point. I said, I'm actually sort of throwing out a question here, probably controversial or not. I think the crying need of the hour is a universal currency for identity, no matter what device, what channel, what environment, what touch point, what screen, what interaction that the consumer has. It has a variety of different applications, marketing, analytics, data, personalization, et cetera. The point here is closed not equal to universal currency, open equal to universal currency.
Okay.
And that's why I'm advocating for open.
Okay, got it. So let's talk about accuracy for a few minutes here, because I think when Facebook launched people-based advertising, we won't call it people-based marketing because perhaps it's not. When they did that, I think there were a lot of people who thought, well, here it is. It's a better data set. It's matched to a login. And Facebook has perfect knowledge and can identify people across their PC and their phone, their tablet. And meanwhile, we have these probabilistic players who, you know, like yourselves, again, correct me if I'm wrong on you being probabilistic, but who have lower accuracy rates. So I think the assumption around the time was your accuracy rates were 60 to 80%. Facebook's were in the 90s, approaching 100. And I'm just using Facebook as the most obvious example. Obviously, there are a lot of big consumer companies that have large data sets matched to a login, Bank of America. Mm-hmm. But let's just sort of throw that one out to you guys, because Nielsen, shortly after Facebook's announcement, started sort of certifying cross-device companies and rated you guys with 90-plus percent accuracy rates. And honestly, I was a little skeptical, and people I've spoken with were a little skeptical about the veracity of those numbers. So, Ari, starting with you, accuracy, probabilistic versus deterministic, and Nielsen, if you could just briefly address the Nielsen thing.
Yeah, absolutely, and we do both. We do both deterministic and probabilistic, plus we work with a lot of companies that have tremendous amount of deterministic data. So I'm starting to get a good view of these two data sets, plus pros and cons with those two types of data sets. So. The and we always do test our data set against. We do probably 2 to 3 tests a week against a bake-off against a deterministic data set. And they show the same thing. They showed that this is plus 90% accurate. But at the same time, there is a lot of, like, I would say, like, early days in terms of how you're actually measuring this. And one of the challenges, and I can say it as since we have deterministic data as well, deterministic data isn't always deterministic. That's a challenge, because one person have multiple email addresses, one device are shared by multiple people, there are multiple browsers on one device, there are multiple street addresses, there are multiple phone numbers. So deterministic data isn't always deterministic either. So when you're testing your data up against a truth set that isn't 100% either, but I think all about everything that we see is that is that this ability to get up north of 90%, and that's, I think, solved for all of the use cases that a marketer has. I think Simon said this good before we started this, in terms of what industry we're in versus what industry we're not in. But for these use cases that a marketer has, plus 90% is more than good enough.
Okay, great. Kamakshi?
I think I'd say that long before sort of the Nielsen measurement came out for declaring those or asserting those 90% plus numbers. The only way for us to continue innovation and development from a technology perspective, because probabilistics is nothing but a technology-aided solution for identity. Using vast amounts of data, machine learning, and smart algorithms are able to synthesize this currency or moniker of identity. And the only way to continue innovation and version and improve upon the algorithmic techniques is you have to have a ground truth set, and you're self-auditing yourself to be able to say that version number 210 of the algorithm is better than version number 209 of the algorithm. That's the only way. So this self-auditing and internal benchmarking of accuracy and reach and coverage is something that we have always been doing even before the Nielsen measurement
came. Okay.
And Nielsen is one such. My point is, any independent entity, let's say a measurement standard, is only at best able to verify or validate a section of the, in our case, 1.2 billion consumers globally. There is no way Nielsen has the ability to measure the entire or validate the entire 1.2 billion consumer graph. So what's being done is a certain subsection of the graph is being validated, and the measurement in terms of accuracy is being declared. So it's certainly possible to get those high 90% accuracy numbers when you're intersecting against a certain subsection of the graph. And the point here is it's not just Nielsen. We're going to be announcing similar numbers with other measurement standards that have access to other sets of ground truth that, when intersected with our graph, give corresponding numbers of accuracy. So I think it is less about dismissing sort of the 90 plus percent number because it sounds so unreal. It's more about understanding what are the ways in which we do scalable tests of validation against ground truth, or in other words, deterministic data, to create confidence in the fact that probabilistic solutions for identity are legitimate here, are here and have arrived and are a clear alternative for a marketer.
Okay, so Tim, let me position this one a little bit differently for you, because you know, 4info is matching devices to home addresses.
Correct.
And you do this by, as I understand it, partnering with apps in many cases to sort of do geo-tracking so that when someone goes home, you've got a map of pretty much all of the residences in the United States.
Correct.
And you just observe where the phone lands for the night. Is that fair to say?
Correct. I mean, that's a very simplified version.
Okay.
But for the purposes of this, yes.
Okay.
But it's a process that is a very lengthy process. It involves billions of data points that are true points of truth. I mean, it's literally a location that matches very specifically with a location to do what we do. So we look at the world a little bit differently, and everybody in this room and everybody in this panel provides value in this ecosystem. We all actually do something a little bit differently. We're very focused on, did an impression actually drive somebody to make a purchase in an offline transaction?
So the value is not just saying, oh, this is where they live, but then taking that home address, matching that to different data sets to track conversion.
Exactly. So where you have ComScore and Nielsen and their rating systems, those are tend to be a little bit more about demographics. We're not as concerned about that. We're more concerned about, did we deliver an ad to a device that belonged to a person that we literally could trace through to a transaction? And for us, that's the ultimate measure of accuracy.
So to tie that back to accuracy, it's fascinating, but you've got things like apartment complexes.
Yep.
You've got things like college dorms,
yep.
condo skyrises.
Yep.
All of those are hundreds or thousands of people under one roof. How can you take that data, that home address data, and presume to match to conversion information down to the user level?
Yeah, so.
Or do you just, that's just part of the disclaimer when someone's working with you, is we're gonna have a little bit of decay of accuracy in the case where we're matching against somebody who lives in a large complex or a big building.
Yeah, I mean, it's a problem everybody has that uses location, but we have two solutions for it. When you look at the U.S. population anyway, the number of people who actually live in multi-unit, multi-story buildings is only about 7%. Now, we usually have this conversation with people in New York who look around them and think that is the world. And so 98% of the people live in those buildings, but that's actually not true.
Okay,
so 7% of the population is a challenge, but we actually work with other app providers who have consumers who are giving up their physical addresses
mm-hmm.
as part of participation in that app. That's part of our solution that allows us to solve for things like apartment
buildings. Okay, so you incentivize people to tell you where they live.
Sure.
Okay,
exactly.
Just to make up for that difference.
Yep,
great.
Exactly.
So there's accuracy and then there's reach. So one thing we talked about, Facebook has big reach. I don't know what their reach is across devices.
We have a number.
What is it?
We have about 200 million users, total users in the US market. About 50 of them log in, 50% of them log in on two or more devices. So that's 100 million. I'm in category Facebook only on my phone. I haven't been to Facebook on my computer in 2 years.
We actually slightly differ from that. We measured it to be.
So then if you start taking that now, that data, and use that outside of the Facebook ecosystem, then you have to start applying a discount rate on that 100 million again as well. So let's say that discount rate is 30-40%, then they're down to 60 million. And in the US, there are about 180 to 200 million consumers that actively use two or more devices.
That's awesome.
We are huge fans and huge believers in everything Facebook does, but you can just use that as an example of the one with absolute highest logged in user database of any company on the planet have about over 60% blind spot with only deterministic data.
Oh.
Right? So which is the realization for many of these social networks as well, is that there's always a huge asymmetry in where people are logging in from. So if Facebook has 60% blind spot, imagine what the drop off is once you start going to smaller companies. And that's again for me, it is proof that there's no right whether you're 100% deterministic, 100% probabilistic. That's not the conversation. The conversation is in order for you to get out to 180, 200 million consumers, you have to do both. There's just no other way.
Mm-hmm.
I'd say this. I'm going to first of all disagree with the point that Ari just said. I think there is no real credible standard here by saying that Facebook doesn't have enough reach. I think that's not the point that we're trying to say. I think the point that has to be argued for is there a way to replicate Facebook's reach with an independent solution that is accessible on a user-by-user basis in terms of their identity for a marketer to action upon? And even from a reach perspective, I think the way in which we break this down is Facebook, from a daily active perspective, just announced about 1 billion consumers that they reach on a daily active basis globally. About 87% of that are mobile users,
mm-hmm.
and about 50% of the mobile users are mobile users only. So that brings the number to more like 430 million users who mm-hmm. can be cross-device, right? So that's the best data that Facebook has shared publicly. So our estimate is that Facebook is actually twice the number that, in terms of the number of users across devices, our estimate is twice the number that Ari just shared here,
okay.
by the rationale that I just shared with you. And
okay.
again, going back to my point, it is not about diminishing the fact that Facebook has a single device reach, because the like button proliferates across every asset outside of the Facebook owned and operated.
Yeah.
So it is a very legitimate estimate to make that 50% of those mobile users who are mobile only users
mm-hmm.
actually are cross device users as well, meaning the remaining 50% are cross device users as well. So Facebook's reach is 400 million plus users.
Okay, great. And then who else is big? Who should be included on the list of like dark horses? 3 to 5 companies that haven't really activated their cross-device data set, but they have it. Mm-hmm. They could. They could bring it into the ecosystem where you guys are playing. They could maybe license it to you. I don't know. Who else is big? Just quickly.
We were talking about this backstage. I'd say that AOL and Apple are someone who don't get talked about a lot.
You said AOL and Apple?
Oh, sorry. Amazon and Apple. Okay. I don't know why I said AOL. Maybe it's.
Well, we'll talk about AOL and Verizon in a second.
I think maybe that was probably why I mentioned AOL. I said Apple and Amazon are the ones that have a tremendous amount of reach in terms of number of users with credit card login data that they have who use their consumer assets across devices. We're talking about well in the north of 400 million plus users. But they don't have a frontline model around marketing or advertising, as a result of which they don't get talked about as often as Facebook and Google, as far as this conversation around cross-device or identity.
What about huge marketers that have relationships with users on multiple devices? Could they license their data to you, or could they create a data co-op? You know, people like Bank of America.
That's what the trend that we've started to see now is, when we started, what we had is like a public device graph that we licensed to everybody.
Okay.
Now we're starting to see this trend of a private device graph, where the marketers and the customers get all our data, but then they combine that with all of their own login data and all of their own touch points. It lives in their own systems, in their own premises, and doesn't leave them, and they don't share it to anyone. But with that, they will get a bigger device graph than anybody else. So we're really starting to see that trend that the marketers want to. That's always a big trend, I think, that's helping all of us on the stage here, is that the marketers earlier were just letting everybody else get their data, and those days are over. The marketers really want to control the data themselves and leverage their own data, their own CRM systems, email, every touch point they have, and have a centralized place for all of this data, and then build these private device graphs and actually then leverage the data across.
That's fascinating because it solves for the security issue, which a lot of marketers are just uncomfortable sharing their customer data into an ecosystem where they can't necessarily control it. I mean, we covered Adobe's attempt to create a data co-op. And many marketers in Adobe's customer set seem to have balked because they're not willing to release
their private
information.
Exactly. Data rights issues.
In a shared environment,
There's no benefit for a marketer to share it with somebody else.
Okay. And
the ones that have the most valuable data, they are the ones that don't want to share it.
And we're not finding that to be completely true, to be honest. We have a very large publisher group that actually has come to us and decided that they want to operate as a co-op because alone they don't have enough scale to survive. Mm-hmm. So they want to work with a platform like ours to be able to consolidate their user base across one data set that they can then share. Mm-hmm. They see it as their only way to survive against the big players in the market.
Mm-hmm. But that is sort of the flip side of the equation. I think that there is no real long-term viability to a data co-op model because the marketer data is so proprietary to themselves. To be able to, especially when you combine the deterministic assets behind them and all the PII implications and create a co-op model, I really find that to be unviable and unsustainable in the long run. And this kind of the private instance of a graph is something that totally makes sense from a marketer's perspective because it preserves the security and the sanctity of their data. It leverages all the value of the deterministic assets and an independent open graph from solutions like ourselves, but they're able to create their own instance of it. So, but that is very distinct from a co-op.
Okay, great. Verizon, what odds do you give the telcos of coming in with their direct relationships with people's phones, with people's televisions in some cases, through their internet access businesses? These companies are clearly paying attention to our space. There's a strong sense that I have that they bought AOL largely in order to activate their mobile data set, those direct device links inside of a media ecosystem. Mm-hmm. It's gonna have to be a scale of 1 to 5, because we have very little time left. What odds do you give companies like Verizon to come be power players in this cross-device world and have their own device graphs?
I would say very, very high. I'd say that the internet companies made hay while the sun shone. The telcos and the ISPs, et cetera, missed out on the party. And it's a long time coming. And I think they're seeing the opportunity right now, especially with some of the proprietary assets of data that they have in conjunction with some of the technology acquisitions that they're able to make. They are able to make a play in this. And it's not just a Facebook, Google ownership of sort of the advertising.
Are you taking meetings with them?
Any strategic partnership, we are open.
I know you have worked directly with carriers.
Yes, absolutely. And I give them a 4 on the scale to 5. I think that Verizon brings a data asset. AOL brings a huge data asset. And now it's a super smart acquisition with Millennial as well. So all of these ones bring really strong data assets in the cross-device space. Plus, I think the industry is also looking for somebody who has real scale. And I also know a lot of people there, so I have to say something nice. but I think they actually think they have a real chance of doing this. I think they have a tremendous amount of execution risk of bringing these organizations together, but the data assets are unique.
Final word, Tim.
I give him a 3.
3, okay. I'm very disappointed we didn't get to talk about privacy, which I think is essential in this space. We'll have to save it for next time. I want to thank you, my panelists, Ari, Kamakshi, and Tim. Thanks so much.